I bend my sight to Kim, who is also lying on grass, in the orchard-like calm of a deserted Liberty Square, reading. And you look up as I tune in, Kim, half-sensing someone. You're doing okay. But even now, on the eve of your departure for a new chapter with a beautiful new love, how little does your OK-ness affect your calm knowledge of how much easier things will be after death? What a sweetness there will be at the moment of dying, the cessation of a struggle whose design has such cruelties for many and such dangers for all. True to its all-purpose aliveness, your imagination obediently conjures up the picture of a perfect, soulless ecstasy of electronic music playing behind the smooth, vanilla-scented silence of a Burne-Jones orchard, where figures from a love song wilt and strum and swoon in glades, and you smile at this. But seriously, Kim, what relief and release it will be from this demanding and uncomfortable situation we're in while alive, when we're always just a narrow squeak away from events that could plunge us into fear, pain, grief, horror, or insanity. How very badly arranged that narrow squeak is. Wouldn't a wide squeak have been a rather more intelligent setting? What a vicious and unforgivable fuck-up, frankly, on the part of whatever process caused this to happen. How exhausting and contemptible that we've been dropped into such a fuck-up, and how very sweet will your assassin be. You'll know him when you see him. You will smell his lovely perfume, and you'll bend to kiss his lethal jeweled hand. On your lips, from this hand, you will drink your elixir, honey, water, Nembutal, and peace at last. Still, as you said before, all this in no way changes the fact that in practice you're genuinely okay, quite content, in fact.